Hello, bookworms. I'm Hannah, and today I'm sharing my September wrap-up. Last month, I read one children's book, 6 middle grade books, 2 YA novels, and 6 adult fiction books for a total of 15 books. In order from least to top favorite, here are the best books I read in the month of September. First up is a short young adult paranormal fantasy, Night of Cake and Puppets by Lainey Taylor. This is a companion story to Taylor's Daughter of Smoke and Bone trilogy, which are some of my all-time favorite books. It follows Zuzanna, or Zuz for short, on the night she and Mick go on their fantastical first date. Lainey Taylor can always be relied on to craft unique characters and settings, and Night of Cake and Puppets is no exception. Zuz is a 4'11" artist and dancer who works as a puppet maker at her father's marionette workshop and refers to herself as a rabid fairy. Her love interest, Mick, is a violinist who longs to do mysterious and improbable things. Together, they traverse a magical night of secret wishes, sugar served in arsenic bowls, art made from bones, and more. Since its release in 2013, this story has only been available as an ebook, but it's finally available in print and it's beautiful. It appears the publisher spared no expense printing this book, and it's packed with signature illustrations by Jim DiBartolo that capture Zuz's personality along with all the weird and wonderful things that inhabit her world. As an added bonus, the book includes the first 2 chapters of Daughter of Smoke and Bone, and it includes a black and white graphic novel adaptation of a scene from that book. Night of Cake and Puppets is young adult fiction to the max. I recommend this book for anyone who enjoys Lainey Taylor's linguistic style or who delights in reading about the electric thrills of young love. The next 4 books are all books that were longlisted for the Man Booker Prize. I already posted a 4-part video series giving spoiler-free reviews of all the books longlisted for this year's prize, so I'm just going to briefly introduce my 4 Man Booker reads. First is 4321 by Paul Auster, a massive work comprised of lengthy page-long paragraphs that explores 4 alternate lives of a man born in Newark in 1947. This sweeping coming-of-age story pulled me in with its intimate writing and well-drawn characters. Second is Elmette by Fiona Mosley, the story of a poor family going head-to-head with a wealthy landowner to save their home. This surprising little debut is reminiscent of Southern Gothic literature and held me captive with its high stakes and atmospheric writing. Elmette is the shortlist book that I'm rooting for to take home the prize. Third is Solar Bones by Mike McCormick, a beautifully written account of an Irishman sitting in his kitchen on All Souls' Day recounting key moments from his life. The story is conveyed in one long, rhythmic sentence across 200 pages and entranced me with its eloquently phrased observations about the frailty of life. And the fourth is Days Without End by Sebastian Barry, a masterfully written account of a young Irishman named Thomas McNulty fighting in the Indian Wars alongside his lover and partner John Cole. Out of my entire long list ranking, this book is second from the top because of its superlative narrative voice, descriptive writing, and memorable portrayal of love and family. Moving on, we get to a recently released picture book, We Sister Strange by Holly Grant, illustrated by K.G. Campbell. This is the story of an orphan girl who lives in a crooked house in the woods. Each night she leaves her home and traverses the forest in search of a bedtime story. This is such an unusual picture book. K.G. Campbell's illustrations, comprised of burnt oranges, golden yellows, and brooding blues, depict wee Sister Strange riding a bear, climbing trees, and swimming through a bog, and the alluring story is written in verse. Wee Sister Strange charms a fierce bear while she rides on its back through groves golden-leafed under sky inky black. She dives into the bog and she swims oh so deep, and she walks on the slime where the bog creatures creep. If you're looking for an atmospheric, lyrical picture book, be sure to check out Wee Sister Strange. Next up is the latest book from the author of The One and Only Ivan, Wish Tree by Catherine Applegate, illustrated by Charles Santoso. This middle grade story is conveyed by Red, a 216-year-old oak tree who's inhabited by all manner of wild animals. On the first day of May, several people who live near Red write down a wish and tie it to one of Red's branches. Throughout the rest of the year, Red is often visited by a little Muslim girl named Samar. Though Red loves Samar's visits, not everyone in her hometown is as welcoming. I'll admit it took me a few pages to get into this book, but once the story took root, I could hardly put it down. Applegate infuses a contemporary setting with a touch of whimsy and uses it as a backdrop to tell a kid-friendly story about racism and intolerance. Wish Tree tackles hate crimes, explores family legacies, teaches young readers about trees and animals, and demonstrates how we are strongest when we are able to overcome our differences and stand together. Charles Santos's illustrations are a charming addition to this poignant story. I especially love the full-page illustration towards the end of the book, though it was a little hard to see because my eyes were brimming with tears. I won't be surprised if this book is in the running for next year's Newbery Medal. It's a beautiful story with several important messages, and I highly recommend it for readers young, old, and every age in between. Now we get to a book I'd been looking forward to reading for months, Patina by Jason Reynolds. This middle grade story follows Patina, a girl who runs on an elite track team that has the potential to make it to the Olympics. Patina runs to put her troubles behind her, but the one thing she can't run from is her bad attitude that's building in tandem with all of the stress in her life. Her coach, who doesn't tolerate bad attitudes, announces the team will be running relay, so Patina must learn to work with and depend on others. Patina is the second book in Jason Reynolds' new track series. Both the first book, Ghost, and the second book are amazing. Reynolds writes about children of color. He makes the best use of first-person perspective, nails narrative voice, and he is too good at tugging his audience's heartstrings. I can always count on Reynolds to infuse his books with myriad important messages for children. He does it in a way that's not obvious or intrusive, so the lessons are learned while young readers enjoy getting lost in a great story. Some of the values taught in Patina are teamwork, patience, and empathy. Some of the topics covered are sports, adoption, diabetes, caring for family, being kind to your sibling, and what it's like to be a black girl in a white school. Just like Ghost, Patina concludes with a scene that had me on the edge of my seat, and I cannot wait to read the next book in the series. When I launched this channel in February, my very first video was a feature on why Jason Reynolds is one of my favorite authors. If you haven't read his books yet, don't walk, run to the bookstore. From one emotionally moving story to another, we arrive at the best book I read in the month of September. It was my Banned Books Week pick, The Diary of a Young Girl by Anne Frank. 13-year-old Anne Frank wrote in her diary from June of 1942 to August of 1944 while in hiding during the Nazi occupation of her homeland. In great detail, Anne explains what it's like to live in a tiny apartment concealed in a warehouse, a cramped space her family of four shares with one man and another family of three. She touches on the woes of sharing one water closet, of not being able to go outside, and of not knowing when they would finally be free. She also reveals what it's like to spend her days tiptoeing and whispering while living in constant fear of being found and shot or sent to the concentration camps. While the war wages outside, Anne wrestles with the common trivialities of growing up. She writes about her relationship with each member of her family, her first inklings of sexual longing, her plan to one day be a wife and a mother, and her dream of being a published author. She conveys her experiences with maturity and elegance. I can't help but wonder what books she'd have written had she been permitted the life she was due. To demonstrate such writing talent at just 13 years of age is awe-inspiring. Over the years, Anne's diary has been challenged or banned for various reasons, for being too depressing, for containing sexual content or portraying homosexual tendencies, and the definitive version, which includes passages that were once omitted by Anne's father, has been accused of containing pornographic passages because Anne writes about her anatomy. It's unfortunate that such an important piece of literature could ever be overlooked because of such trivial details. This is the first time I've read this book, and I feel so fortunate that Anne's diary wasn't lost, destroyed, or kept secret. That concludes my September wrap-up. What was the best book you read in the month of September? Tell me in the comments below. Thanks, everybody!